Okay, so good evening, everyone. Once again, we are back with fundamental analysis of stocks. And this week, we have three great stocks and one stock which we should listen to very carefully. So talking about three great stocks that we are covering this week is Suprajit. They are into auto industry and almost have a monopoly in the brake wire industry. Similarly, we have Moltec Technologies, which are having a market share of almost 90% in lubricant segment and almost like 50-odd% in paint segment with different manufacturers like Asian Paint, Berger Paints, AkzoNobel. They have more than 60% also. And we have a multi-bagger from last 10-15 years in the manufacturing of APIs, that is Divi's Laboratory. Most of the people who are investing into stocks in last 10-12 years must be knowing about this stock. And we will be going little deep on why Divi's Laboratory is such a good stock despite having such a high PE and some numbers which actually show that it is overvalued. But yes, it is overvalued because the company is like that. It is charging a premium from you to invest in this company. Before going deep into analysis of all these stocks, let me give you a little brief that I normally talk about different parameters. And this week, I am last 7 days, I was busy covering up review of very latest book by Saurabh Mukherjee, which is Diamonds in the Dust. So I have ordered this copy. You can look here. And this is a very, very nice book for everyone who is very, very interested in going very deep into fundamental analysis. So it is actually covering about how Team Marcellus is actually going, doing analysis about various stocks. It is covering you, giving you various checklists also, accounting checklist, where does brand work, where does brand does not work, what are the key forensic parameters, how do you spot naughty lenders in finance and banking and NBFCs? And they have also discussed about the, what are the various myths in Indian investing also. It's a very good book. Probably they have given you more than somewhere around 8 to 10 checklists. If you are a fundamental investor or you want to do research on various stocks like Suprajit, Divi's, there are almost like 100 great stocks that we have in our industry, apart from 20 consistent compounders, probably 40-50 more stocks that are almost giving similar results. I think you can actually buy this book and you can go reading this book very slowly, because the kind of checklist that they have given, how do they have almost given you 8 to 10 different case studies, including the failed companies like Manpasand Beverages, Amtech Auto, Cox and Kings. They have actually detailed that there were red flags before the company going bankrupt or going to an NCLT route. For those right companies which have sales growth year on year at least 10%, they have been growing it. With this, I hand over the presentation duty to Rahul.
Akshita?
Yes.
Got disconnected. So over to you, Akshita. You can start your presentation.
Sure, sir. So hello, everyone. Thank you all for joining. Today, we are going to discuss the fundamental research on the stock Suprajit. So moving on to the company overview, Suprajit Engineering is promoted by Mr. Ajit Kumar Rai. He started the company as a single product supplier to single client, that is the TVS Motor, in the year 1985. Over the years, Suprajit has emerged as the largest supplier of mechanical cables to domestic two-wheeler segments, enjoying higher share of business across major two-wheelers OEMs. It has also emerged as a significant supplier to domestic passenger vehicles OEMs with a rising revenue share from the aftermarket and exports. A key part of the Suprajit growth strategy in the recent year has been acquisitions. This has not only helped strengthen its core automotive cable business through the acquisition of Shark Concaves and Tricol Speedo Cables, which helped the firm gain footholds in the CV and passenger vehicle segments respectively, but also helped diversify into newer products such as automotive headlight lamps and the non-auto segments. Moving on to the business segmentation, there are four segments in which the Suprajit is working. First is the automotive, then two-wheeler, non-automotive, and aftermarket. So, moving on to these segments, automotive cables contribute 60% of revenues of the total Suprajit Engineering Limited. And automotive cables contribute 16.3% in EBITDA margin. And its key clients are the TVS, Hero, Bajaj, Royal Enfield, Yamaha, etc. In the passenger vehicle segments, its clients are Mahindra and others. In aftermarket, its own distribution and OE workshop. So a market share of 65% in two-wheeler OEMs and 25% in passenger vehicle OEMs, strong presence in aftermarket, largely grown organically and through small acquisition, which we have already discussed, the Shark Concaves and Tricol Speedo Cables. Its exports is largely of OEMs, and the key clients are the Volkswagen, BMW, Renault, and other European PV OEMs. Front end based out of UK and manufacturing in India. In the automotive lamps contributes 20% of revenue and 12.1% in EBITDA margin. Its presence across most passenger vehicles and two-wheeler OEMs in India. Aftermarket bigger share is acquired in financial year 16, high market share in supply of halogen lamps to automotive OEMs in India. Moving on to the exports, largely exports of aftermarket, private labeling for some European brands plus on distribution. Nearly 70% of revenue from aftermarket in India and Europe, recently acquired Osram India's facility in Tamil Nadu. And non-automotive cables contribute 20% of revenue and 14.8% in EBITDA margin. Its key clients are MTD, Toro, Zon, Dire, Honda. Acquired in the year financial year 17, market leader in outdoor power equipment cables in the USA. Moving on to the industry overview. So the Indian auto sector comes in the top five largest auto industries of the world. India is also a prominent auto exporter and has strong export growth expectation for the near future. The support from the government is providing the auto companies with a boost needed in their development. The global automotive cable market is estimated to surpass $6.5 billion mark by 2026, growing at an estimated CAGR of more than 6.9% during the forecasted period. Key drivers for this automobile cable segment were the increase in number of electronic components used in the cars. As the auto sector is now focusing more on these electronic segments, so this led to the increase in demand of the electronic components. Moving on to the segments and geographic synergies, if we compare the financial year one, 96% of revenue is come from the two-wheeler segment. And if we compare this with the current year, two-wheeler segment contributes only 35%. So that means Suprajit has diversified its product in almost all these categories. If we compare this performance geography-wise, 99% of its revenue come from the domestic market in the year 2001 and 2 versus only 60% revenue is coming from domestic market in the current year. That means company has diversified its products not only in the domestic market but also in the international markets. Moving on to the leadership. So Mr. K. Ajit Kumar Rai, he is the founder and chairman of the company. N.S. Mohan is the managing director of the company. While Akhilesh Rai, he is the CSO director of Suprajit Group. James Ryan, he is the president of Suprajit US. Akhilesh Goel, he is the CEO of Phonix. Frank Clayton, he is the CEO of Trifa. Narayan Shankar, he is the CEO of SEL. Peter Greensmith, CEO of SEL, Director SEL. Steve Ficker, CEO of Sena. Gopal Doriswamy, VP Sales, Americas. Praveen Rai, he is Mr. VP Marketing, PLD, DCD. Ashutosh Rai, he is the head, STC Suprajit Group. And Medapa Bodhwa, he is CFO and CS Suprajit Group. moving on to its capacities, Suprajit has not only increased its cables produced, but it also has increased its cables capacities from 80 million to 300 million. And if we talk about its revenue splits, cable contributes 80% of its revenue, while bulk contributes only 20% of the revenue. So there are various key success factors for Suprajit. First one is the clear cost advantages over its peers. So Suprajit has a well-thought strategy vision of emerging as a global leader in all of its product lines. That is automotive cables, automotive lamps, and non-automotive cables. The key to achieving this leadership is to be an efficient, low-cost supplier of these products while meeting the customer expectation on quality delivery and designs. So it has advantage in terms of cost over its peers. Moving on to the next is the prudent capital allocation, continuous investment in manufacturing capacities. So Suprajit has been proactive in expanding its cable manufacturing capacities. As we have seen earlier, that Suprajit has acquired various companies to expand its manufacturing capacities, leaving little room for its peers to benefit from the market growth. In the last 10 years itself, it has organically tripled its cable manufacturing capacities, reinvesting nearly 40% of standalone cash flows in CapEx. Besides the increase in overall cable manufacturing capacities, there are two other dimensions to Suprajit's organic expansion strategy. Next is the building management bandwidth allocation to build a scalable organization structure. Sufficient integration of acquisition and managing business with diverse geographical footprints require efficient allocation of management bandwidth. Suprajit has been successful in this regard through retaining existing management of acquired entities as well as making changes when required. So moving on to the SWOT analysis of Suprajit. So firstly, let's look at its strength. So some of the strengths of Suprajit are the high margins, intellectual property rights, first mover advantage, robust domestic market that Suprajit Automotive operates in, strong relationship with existing suppliers. Mutual funds have increased their shareholding last quarter, which we further look on in the shareholding pattern. Consistently high return over 5 years, good quarterly growth, company with low debt, company with zero promoter pledge, and FII has increased their shareholding. Its weakness are the decline in net profit. Quarter on quarter, its profit has declining. Technicals showing bearish reversal. Moving on to the opportunities, reducing capacity word over for the halogen bulbs and vacated by some of the biggest players. Provide company to expand into these territories and grow the market share in a dwindling market. Significant potential for additional business from customers who may resource from current geography to India. Good export potential for cables and halogen lamps in the OEM business. Good potential to grow in the domestic business and in the aftermarket. Some more opportunities are potential to secure additional business from new model launches in the OEM segment in India and overseas. Potential to grow aftermarket through OLM brands as well. Introduction of additional products for the aftermarket. Strategy opportunities in inorganic space considering the COVID-19 pandemic and resultant financial difficulties for certain strategic assets. Global consolidation in the cable industries provide opportunity for your company to be a consolidator and enhance its global position in the light duty cable segment. Moving on its threats, COVID-19 continued to be a major threat, which has led to economic slowdown and uncertainties. So COVID-19 had impacted almost all the sectors, especially the auto sectors. Another problem that the company is facing is the global chip shortage, which is disrupting the supply chain of many of the OEMs worldwide and also in India. That could impact the volume of takes and new product launches. Next to service quality and delivery issues can lead to cost and margin erosion, increase in commodity prices and availability. Currency fluctuation has also impacted the company as the company has diversified its product, not only in the domestic market, but in the international market. Next is the labor shortage. LED replacing the halogen bulbs continue to be a threat in the OE segment. Electrical and electronic could pose a threat to the fit and form of the current cable requirements and will need more innovative functioning in these vehicles with the cables. So moving on to the financials, Suprajit has shown a healthy performance with growth in the net sales. From financial year 9 to financial year 21, Suprajit's sales has increased from 27.8 million to 221.1 million. And the company is able to maintain healthy EBITDA margin of around 14.4%. Company has very low debt to equity ratio, that as you can see on the screen, that the debt to equity ratio is in the declining trend. That means the company is now focusing to reducing its debt from the balance sheet. So all these factors give us the green signal about the company's financials. Moving on further, as you can see in the first diagram, company's actual earnings are far more than the company's estimated earnings. That means company is able to increase its revenue and income more than what it has planned. Moving on to the income statement, company's revenue is consistently increasing and net income is also increasing, but at a very slow rate. And profit margin has declined from the year 2017 to 19. Then from the year 19 to 20, it has increased. So if one wants to invest in this stock, one should wait for at least one or two more quarters to see whether this company is able to maintain, to increase its profit margin or to maintain its revenue, increasing revenue. Moving on to the balance sheet, total assets are more than the total liabilities. That means at the time of liquidation, the company has enough assets left after paying for its liabilities for the investors. And as we have this, moving on to the cash flows, so its cash flow from operating activities is in the increasing trend. And if we see, there is an cash outflow from investing as well as financing activities, but overall net cash flow is positive for the company, which is very good. Moving on to the ratios, first is the sales growth. As you can see, sales growth is in the increasing trend, which is a good sign for the company. Profit growth, ROE and ROCE, they all have declined from the year 17 to 19, but from the year 19 to 20, it has increased. And the company has a ROE of more than 12%. That means the company is giving returns to its equity shareholders of more than 12%, which is a good sign. Similar case with the ROCE. ROCE is also more than the 12%. It's around 16.74%. So its debt to equity ratio is 0.33, which we have discussed already, that company is focusing on reducing its debt. Next is price to cash flow. As price to cash flow tells us that the price is company's price is trading as compared to its cash flows. So it is more than the lower the better price to cash ratio. But in this case, the Suprajit has a more price to cash flow ratio, which is giving us a red signal for the investors. Moving on to the interest coverage ratio. So higher the interest coverage ratio, the better it is. As in this case, it's 11.11%. That means company's earnings are enough to pay for the interest, which is the green signal for the company. Next is the CFO by PAT ratio. That CFO, that means cash flow from operations divided by its net income. That means company is earning company is having a more cash flow from operation than its net profit, which is a green signal for the investor. So it should be more than one. And in this case, it is more than 1.5. Moving on to the liquidity position of the company. So its current ratio. Current ratio is current assets divided by current liabilities, which tells us whether the company has enough current assets to pay for its current liabilities or not. In this case, it is consistently increasing. That means company's assets is increasing as compared to company's current liabilities, which is a green signal for the investors. Moving on to the quick ratio. Quick ratio is also increasing. That means without selling its inventory, company can pay for its current liabilities easily. So overall, the company is able to meet its short-term obligations. Moving on to the solvency ratio. So its debt ratio is declining. So Suprajit is now focusing to reduce long-term debt. That's why its debt to equity ratio is decreasing, which is a positive sign for the investors. Moving on to the profitability ratio. So in profitability ratio, higher the ratio, better it is. In the EBITDA margin, so it is not showing increasing trend nor a decreasing trend. It is increased in 1 year, then it has decreased. So we should wait for 1 or 2 years. And in according to the net profit margin is in the increasing trends. That means it has increased from 10% to 12%, which is a good sign for the investors. Moving on to some other important ratios. First is the inventory turnover ratios. So inventory turnover ratio tells us whether the company is able to sell off its inventory or not. In this case, its inventory turnover ratio is declining. That means company is not able to sell its inventory. So it is a red signal for the investors. Then next we have is the EV by EBITDA. It tells us what you are paying to earn 1 rupee in future. So if we see in the year 2017, investors are paying 21 rupees to earn 1 rupee in future. But in the year 2020, where we are now, we have to pay only 18 rupees to earn 1 rupee in future. That means company is available at cheaper price now. Price to book value. So the lower the price to book value ratio, the better it is. In this case, it is continuously decreasing. So that means it is a green signal. Moving on to the assets turnover ratio. Assets turnover ratio tells that the company is using its asset effectively or not. So it is declining, which is a red signal. It should be in the increasing trend. Next is the free cash flows. So free cash flows are those cash flows left after paying for the capital expenditure. So although the cash flow is declining, but it's still positive. So which is a green signal for the investors. Next we have is the net income and cash flow from operations. So net income and cash flow from operations should ideally be parallel. An ideal company has a higher profit operating cash flow than its net profit. So Suprajit has more operating cash flow than the net income, which is a green signal for the investors. Moving on to the peer comparison. So if we compare Suprajit with its peers like Endurance Technologies, Minda Industries, Webco India, Sundaram Clayton, Mara Scooters and others. So we can see the Suprajit is a small cap company with a market cap of around 4,472.89 crores. And its price to book value is 5.08. And if we compare it with the peers, so most of its peers have more price to book value. That means the company is available currently at cheaper price. Its PE ratio is also less as compared to the peers, and its industry PE ratio is around 33. So that means according to the PE ratio, company is currently available at cheaper price. Its earning per share is 12.43, although all the companies' EPS is more, but they also have more market cap. In terms of ROE and ROCE, the company has very good ROE and ROCE as compared to its peers. And moving on to the EV by EBITDA, its EV by EBITDA is also good, as you can only pay, you are only paying 17 rupees to earn 1 rupees. While for its peers, you are paying a higher amount to earn same rupee. So let's move to the shareholding pattern. From the shareholding pattern, you can clearly see the shares of the promoters have increased in this quarter from 44.57 to 44.62%. And FII has also increased their shareholding this quarter, same with the DII. That means the promoters, FII and DII, they all are expecting that it will give a huge return in future. So moving on to the technical charts. In the past year, it has given a return of around 80%, which is very good. If you have invested 100 rupees a year ago, that means you will have received around 180 rupees. And its past 5 years, it has given only 67.13%. So that means the company is currently performing well as compared to its in the past. So we can expect that in the future, it would also perform well. So let's move to the conclusion part. The main stream of revenue for auto sector is their sales. Suprajit Engineering has reported poor sales growth. Although its sales is increasing, but it has only increased by 3.86%. And in the last quarter, sales was ₹209.08 crores. To judge whether the company's inventory is being sold or not, and the sales picture is true, inventory turnover ratio plays a major role, which we have already discussed. The inventory turnover ratio has declined. So that means the company is not able to manage its inventory. The company's reported profit growth of 11.83% over the years, where the latest year profit is ₹137.92 crore, compared to the previous year of ₹123.33 crores. And the new permits by government and increasing demand will lead to an increase in profits in the coming year. So by looking at its profit growth, the company is giving it the green signal. So the operating profit of the company in the last quarter is ₹31.92. It helps in measuring the company's operating performance, which is used to make financial decisions. Suprajit Engineering has an average ROE of 16.42%, but its ROE is more than its peers. And the ROE is an important financial parameter because auto companies work with high equity investments. Although they have to take huge debt to incur the research and manufacturing work, so their debt to equity ratio should be evaluated. And Suprajit Engineering has a lower debt to equity ratio of around 0.2. Suprajit Engineering pays a dividend of ₹1.75 per share. It tells us that a company likes to share profit with its shareholders. The dividend yield is low at 0.54%. The share of promoters has also increased from 44.57% to 44.62%. And there is no pledging, so which is a green signal. What the market is willing to pay for the company for its earnings can be determined by its PE multiple. And current PE of Suprajit is 26 compared to the 5-year average PE of 29.38. That means company is now available at a cheaper price. So overall, the fundamentals of Suprajit Engineering look average, and hence you may wait for the results to improve to invest for the longer term. So thank you. This report is for education purpose only. Do your own research before investing. Thank you.
Excellent, excellent presentation, Akshita. And literally, I have seen you growing over the last 3 presentations. Now in this presentation, you were also covering the trend of shareholding by FII and DII. It is a major indicator of how foreign institutions or domestic institutions are investing into a stock. And increasing, it also giving us confidence that probably if foreign institutions or DIIs are investing into the stock, then probably this stock must be doing something right. All right. So wonderful presentation to all our viewers who are actually watching this live. You can actually subscribe to the channel so that you can get such regular updates, some deep fundamental analysis of such great companies again and again. So after this, we will be moving on to Meenakshi, and she will be covering with Divis. Meenakshi, over to you.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. The screen is visible, sir. Okay. Let's start. Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for joining here today us for a very interesting stock analysis of Divi's Labs. Well, investor, even a new investor or an old investor will definitely be knowing a little bit about Divi's Laboratories. It's a big name. It's basically a small monopoly in its own segment. So let us see what makes Divi's a monopoly in its own area, and let's see what makes it the stock which it is right now for investors. So talking about the company, Divi's Laboratory is a leading manufacturer. Now, what does Divi's Labs do? It's basically a producer of active pharmaceutical ingredients, that is APIs. It provides these active pharmaceutical ingredients to many manufacturers in India and abroad as well. It's a trustworthy brand, as sir mentioned in the beginning, that it is a big name and an old name in this industry for the past 10 to 15 years. So Divi's operates from its headquarters in India itself, and it is registered office at Hyderabad. The company has currently 6 multipurpose manufacturing units and operates from 2 sites, all support infrastructure like utilities, environment management, and safety system. So this is a short brief about Divi's Labs. Now looking up to the some basic data about Divi's Labs, we can see that as Divi's, we have seen that it's a big name and has been in the industry for 10 to 15 years. It has currently a human capital of around 17,000 employees. And along with that, Divi's has a very good R&D section. Divi's conducts and promotes various safety training sessions, development sessions for its employees, various research facilities. As mentioned earlier, Divi's has two manufacturing units in India. Also, a point here to mention is that Divi's currently operates in more than 95 countries across the globe. So although manufacturing completely in India, Divi's provides various drugs to more than 95 companies across the globe. It has almost 40 process patents on its name. It has been funding good in the R&D section, that is 12,403 lakhs. There are more than 4 lakh beneficiaries from Divi's. Now coming to the financials, Divi's has more than 6.5 lakhs revenue in total revenue. Its EBITDA is very strong at more than 2.88 lakhs. The profit after tax is also close to 2 lakhs. So this is some key highlights of Divi's Laboratories. Now talking about the management of Divi's Lab. Divi's Lab was founded by Dr. Murali Divi, and he is currently the managing director of Divi's Lab himself. So we can see that the management of the company is currently strong. He is also assisted by his son, Dr. Kiran Divi, who is the CEO of the company. So, and looking at all the other members of the management, we have Dr. Ramesh, Dr. Rao, Dr. Ganapati. So we can see that the management of the company is very strong, which is a good factor and a positive factor for the company, which shows faith is a point for faith for the investors and proper management and planning of the company. Looking at the shareholding pattern of the company, we have 51% contributor to the promoters. We have FII investing in this company for holding more than 20%, which is a very good number. We have also DIIs investing in Divi for at 16.5%. And the public shareholding is around 11%. So what we have the observance from shareholding pattern is that the FIIs have increased their holdings from 19.87% to 20.6% in the June 21 quarter. So what we can see is that FIIs have started investing more in the company, hence showing faith in the company. The number of FIIs investing in the company have also increased. Moreover, the mutual funds holdings in the company have also increased from 12.59% to 12.6%. The promoter holdings, although remains changed, the institutional investors have also increased their holdings from 36.6% to 37%. Hence, it shows a good faith and investment from FIIs and DIIs as well. Moving on, having a look on the revenue from, as mentioned, 95 different countries for Divi, we can see that the revenue share percent of Divi from America almost it has decreased 10%. And in Europe, it has increased by 7% in the past 5 years. The share in Asia and India has almost remained the same. So what we can deduce from the above data is that we can see major portion of the revenue coming from Europe and America, the comparative compared to other parts of the world where Divi's operates. So we can see that we can see an opportunity here where Divi's can grow and develop, increase its, try to increase more of its revenue in America and Europe, although maintaining maintaining a good hold in areas where the revenue is stable, that's India and rest of the world. Now talking about the percent bifurcation of the revenue of Divi's, So 34.48% is costing to the raw material. We can see that Divi's is highly investing in the supply of raw materials for its APIs. That's the major source of income for Divi. 9.8% is the expense for tax. We have finance costs very negligible. We have change in inventory of finished goods and work in progress at 1.46%. Also, along with that, we can see that Divi's has been managing its expenses very well. More profitability can be increased by having cost reductions at many places, like the cost of raw materials and in finished goods storage and inventory purposes. Now, having a quick SWOT analysis of the strengths, weakness, and opportunities Divi's is having now, we can see that Divi's, as seen earlier, has a strong hold in 95 different countries and has a stable growth in Asia and in Indian region. So along with maintaining that, that is a good strength for Divi. The Divi, as we have seen, that the growth in net profit has increased with increasing profit margin quarter on quarter. There has also been a growth in quarterly net profit with increasing profit margin. The company has near to zero debt. That is a very good green signal for the investors. Along with strong cash generating ability from the core business, company has also improving cash flow from operation for the last 2 years. So this is also a green signal for investors. The company was also able to generate net cash, improving net cash flow for last 2 years. Annual net profits have been improving for the last 2 years. Also, the book value per share has been improving for last 2 years. We will talk more about the book value per share in the further slide, where we'll analyze why, even though having a more PB ratio, the stock has been having good reviews. Along with that, as seen in the shareholding pattern, the company has seen increase in FIIs investors and also increase in number of DIIs holding. So along with that, a technical factor here to note is that the company has stock price has recently reached its 52-week high. So that is also a good green signal for investors, shows faith in the company. Moving on, the only weakness we can see here is that company with growing cost year on year for long-term projects. So we can see that Divi has been investing more in a long-term project. And talking about opportunities, as mentioned earlier, there is good opportunity for Divi in areas of America and Europe, where it can try to invest more and increase its revenue percentage from those areas. We have also seen negative to positive growth in sales and profit with strong price momentum. As opportunities, we can see that we have seen upcoming results which show positive shift in the share price. The results are good, positive, and show a promising good near future for the company. Talking about the threats this company has, as mentioned earlier, it is a stock with high PE. So we will talk about this further. Now, having a look on the financials, we can say that the capital employed in the last 5 years has almost increased more than 50%, around close to 50%. The net fixed assets have grown more than 50% in the last 5 years. The current net current assets have also increased more than 5 years. So we can see that the company is performing good and has been able to increase its net worth from 53,000 to 92,000, which is a good green signal for the investors. Now, seeing about the income statement, we have, as we can see, the PAT is showing a good increase over the past 5 years from 10,000 to 19,800. The total expenditure, though increased as seen earlier, it has maintained the EBITDA has still standing good, increased more than 15% from 14,460 in financial year 17 to 28,983 in the financial year 21. So that is also a green signal for the company. As mentioned earlier, the revenue of the company has been increasing year on year. The market capitalization, as mentioned earlier at the start of the session, that the company is having quite a monopoly in its sector, the pharma sector, in providing APIs. As it's an old and strong player in the industry, the market capitalization is good at 96,17,396. Now looking at the cash flow statement, we can see that the net change in cash and net cash equivalent is 1,987. The operating activities, net cash flow from operating activities has also shown a positive trend, that is 43.15. From investing activities too, it has shown a positive trend. Now we can see that the year-on-year growth has been almost, though rise increasing in one of the year, 48 point year, it has tried to increase and maintained a stable position since for the past 3 years. So that is also a point to note here. Now a quick review on so far the financial statements show a slight of positive review for Divi's. So let's see what the ratios have to tell us. Liquidity ratio, the first is current ratio, which is the ratio of current assets upon current liabilities. So as we can see, though not much change in the current ratio, it has managed to maintain at a certain level, which is a average sign for the company. The quick ratio has been increasing, which shows us that the company is very well in place to pay off its all of its liabilities at a good position, even though not exhausting its all of its assets. So that is a good sign for the investors. The solvency ratio, that is debt to equity ratio, has though at the start of 2017 it was 0.01, it is now at zero for the past 2 years. As mentioned earlier, this is because the company has almost zero debt. So the only debt or the funding this company gets is for its operating activities for the production of APIs. But apart from that, the company is completely debt free. So this is also a green sign for the investor. The profitability ratio, the return on assets. So even though falling in the year 2018, the company has managed to increase its return on assets percent and is now standing good at 18.41%. The net profit margin of the company, although falling in 2018, has shown an increasing trend and is standing strong at 28.47%. So that is also a green signal for the investors. Now looking at other important ratios of the company, the inventory turnover ratio is almost in the same range for the past 5 years. The EV by EBITDA ratio has seen a tremendous increase in the past 5 years and is now currently at 32.23, so which is also a good sign for the company. Now coming, as mentioned earlier, the price by book value. So the company, as we can see, that it can be pursued or interpreted as overvalued, but the company has been giving good results, and the company, I would like to mention here, that is paying 30% dividend to its shareholders. Along with that, has been providing good profits and good financials, along with having zero debt. So the company, in short, we can say, is demanding a premium, as sir mentioned at the start of the session, that demanding premium to invest in their company. So even though the price by book value is high, the company, it is considered as a good and positive sign for the investors. The asset turnover ratio has almost same for the past five years, and the ROCE, return on capital employed, is also almost same for the past five years. Now comparing Divi with other of its competitors, we can see that the Divi has a market price of 5,214 and is the second largest company, having second in ranking, second in market capitalization. Divi's, though having ranking second, is completely, we can say, having a little monopoly in this segment and performing compared to others ratios. It is price by book value, as we can see here, is 14.89, which is highest compared to all of its peers. But the company has also given highest ROE compared to all of its peers. So hence, the just price by book value is justified here, and hence makes it a better stock, we can say, compared to all of its peers in community factor, considering all the factors and financials and ratios compared to other competitors. Now, the key points to mention here is the total operating income grew by 8.9% and stood at 5,882 crores. The cash and liquid investments grew to 999 crores. Exports account for, as I mentioned earlier, the company is majorly exporting APIs to other companies. So hence, 86% of gross sales in financial year 20 came due to exports to and mainly to the European market. So hence, this is an opportunity and one of the strengths for Divi, the European market, we can say. The industrial growth is also expected to grow around 10%. The compounded profit and sales growth stands at 10% and 12%. So as mentioned earlier, the Divi has also paid a healthy dividend of 30.84%. And debt, as seen in the ratio, has completely reduced and now stands at zero. So concluding the all analysis of Divi, we can say that Divi has had a successful track record with leading market share in the supply of large volume APIs on the back of proactive capacity addition, technology upgrades, driving cost efficiency, consistent compliance, as well as robust supply chain management. It is still supplying the products it started operations with, which showing both its strength in these products in addition to continuing demand for its legacy products. So it is well positioned to deliver strong earnings CAGR over the next 2 years, that is 32%. Divi delivered in line in the fourth quarter. It also ended financial year 21 on a strong note, with a growth in sales, EBITDA and PAT with 29%, 57% and 54% respectively. New product development, ongoing capex and strong prospects in custom synthesis provides confidence that the momentum in earnings growth will sustain over the next 2-3 years. Though the court judgment if in favor of Divi would enable handling over of the remaining land and kicking start the Kanikada project. Capex in this project is expected to be 6 billion INR. So this is a very big point to note here, that if the judgment lands in favor of DV, then the share price is expected to even boost further. Although it has just reached its 52-week high recently. Now to conclude, we can say that the company has high growth aspects with no debt and high cash reserves. So investors can definitely consider. But I would like to say a disclaimer that please do your own analysis before investing in the stock. Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Meenakshi. Given this is probably the first time that you're presenting to YouTube live viewers. So excellent presentation. And you have actually covered very, very good points about Divi's. So just adding my 2 cents about this company, Divi's, is this company is actually involved in 90%, close to 90% is from their export income. Yeah. So a company into pharma sector getting their 90% of income from the exports, I think FDA would have been a major concern. If you go and go back and check the histories of major pharma companies like Sun Pharma or more, I think most of them have been embroiled with different kind of issues with FDA. But talking about Divi's, it has been more or less having a very clean sheet up with FDA. I think only one or two minor issues with FDA, which has been cleared also. So apart from that, if you talk about why Divi's is such a good company, okay, everybody is saying that they are a very good company, API manufacturer, this and that, giving very good ROC numbers of 25% plus, which is an excellent number. But I think what actually differentiates Divi's from other pharma companies is it's actually its regulatory process. It is 100% IP compliant, and the kind of contract that is had with different kind of companies of non-competing service provider. I think this is a very key pointer of why Divi's is doing so great. See, if I am a company like Abbott or any other company which is giving my business outsourced to Divi's, if I don't have trust with Divi's, that probably down the line, if I need to share my IP with Divi's. So if I don't trust Divi's, probably I would be looking for some other competitor. But now that I have been working with Divi's from last 30 years, it has signed a non-competing service provider contract with me. And I think for any new competitor to come in and get that contract away from Divi's is very, very difficult. We know that Divi's is very good in manufacturing of APIs, but this special category that they have signed a non-competing service provider and they have actually followed it to the core, I think they have actually won the trust of each and every supplier for whom they are actually doing it, third-party manufacturing. So probably this is the reason that Divi's is also charging premium. They know that they have kind of a monopoly or kind of a, what do you say, entry barrier for somebody else, a new company to come in and get that contract from companies. I think it is very difficult. So Divi's have been a good stock and probably I think would be a good stock to invest in future. But then you always have to do your own research before investing. So now we move on to Rahul, our next champion. And Rahul would be presenting about Moltec Packaging. Over to you, Rahul.
So a very good evening to everyone who has joined in for the live session today. I'm going to be giving a fundamental analysis of the stock Mold Industries. And to be specific, the mold tech packaging industry that we're talking about. So coming to the brief introduction of the topic, it engages in manufacturing and sale of plastic packaging products. It provides containers for pharma and cosmetic products, closures, caps, bottles, flip-top, tablet, tube-type pharma packs, and blow-molded shampoo and medicine packs. So it provides a lot of a variety of plastic products for, you know, packaging for other kind of small pieces of packaging and even the overall containers. So Moltec Packaging also offers injection molded plastic coin pail with in-mold or external pouch for packaging lubes and so on. Company serves pharmaceutical, paint, lubricant, cosmetic, and the FMCG industries. Moltec Packaging was previously known as Moltec Plastics Limited. It is currently based in Hyderabad. Coming to the company background, it was founded in 1985 by technocrats Mr. Lakshmana Rao, who is now the current MD, and A. Subramaniam, who is now the current deputy MD. The company commands a strong presence across all major customers like Asian Paints, Castrol, Shell, Mondelez, HUL, etc. And what kind of pushed Moltec forward and what has been a major support for Moltec has been its innovation in bringing new products and bringing something very specific to the market. But when they sell that product, they have ensured that they are one of the only sellers. They overall have a market monopoly over the same. And they have a very specific market segment, but they make sure that they cover it entirely. Further equipped with in-house mold designing capabilities, Moltec pioneered the adoption of plastic pails for paints industry in early 1990s, gradually replacing the then prevalent tin containers. So today, if you see, you'll see the plastic buckets instead of the older tin containers in many cases. So those were innovated and those were basically adopted by Moltec. In the recent years, the introduction of in-mold labeling technology for food and FMCG industry has been a major driver of revenue and profit growth for Moltec. What is their mission statement? We commit ourselves to ensure customer satisfaction by providing innovative products and services that meet their needs and expectations based on agreed specifications through excellence in quality, delivery, and services. This is their NSE chart. As you can see over the years, it has grown. It has shown an overall growth. So if you look very carefully, here towards the COVID-19 period, there was a small dip. But even then, post the COVID-19 pandemic, from 2021 to 2020 to 2021, there has been a very sharp increase. And in the last year, Moltech has been an amazing stock. For anyone who held it throughout, this has given crazy returns, and it's clearly one of the that is clearly one of the reasons why we are discussing it today, since it's such a big stock in the market right now. Coming to the BSE charts, show a similar image. You can see that there have been increases, and this chart is covering even the past from 2012 onwards. So as you can see, there was a gradual increase, then a slight dip in 2020-2021 due to COVID, and then now it has again increased to exponential heights. Coming to the company performance, so if you look very carefully, you'll see that the share prices are a reflection of the company performance, and there have been very high net sales over the past few years. But as I have repeatedly said, COVID especially hit. When you have a situation of COVID, the first thing that you get rid of are the luxuries and the bigger things. So paints and, you know, painting your houses and getting paints and getting plastic products like this, this becomes a very later objective in your mind. So that is why paintings and all these were declined over the last year majorly. But over this quarter, as if you look very carefully in the 2022 quarter one, it is expected that it will outgrow its performance from 2020, and it will bounce back stronger than ever before, which can be even be seen right now in the current figures also, be it the share price, be it the revenue, be it the profits. It's jumping back, and it's jumping back very strongly. This is the profit in crores for over the past few years. And if you look here, you'll see that even in the COVID-19 pandemic, the profits did not fall. The profits were increasing throughout. Even when the revenue was hit, even if the everything else was hit, they made sure that they made consistent profits, which for a manufacturing industry is a very great point, because last year, even if service industry could catch up, manufacturing industry and product based industries have declined very sharply. So coming up like this has proved to be a very golden point for Moltech. The cash flow statement. So if you look, as I've explained before also, so in cash flows, if the operating activity cash flow is positive and higher, it is generally a very good sign. That means that they are getting their money, they are getting a positive amount of money from their cash flows, they are getting a positive amount of money from their operating activities, which is their day-to-day activities. If they're in the investing and the financing activities are more in the long-term area, so if this is negative, even if it's negative right now, it could be an indication of future growth. Since investing and financing right now, and if you're putting more money right now, that means that in the future you expect there to be higher returns. You can expect there to be higher profits from the same, and that would increase the cash from operating activity in the foreseeable future. The net cash flow stands at approximately zero every year, so you can expect that it generally their investing and their operating, it generally balances each other out, so that there is no perfect outcome, no balance, no bias towards any of them. The debt to equity ratio here is 0.39, 0.54, 0.47, which is slightly higher. It should be lower, but since it's a company that runs on product based things, it is very in these companies, especially debt to equity debt, there can be higher debts, because they need money, they need capital for investing into products, they need capital for investing into machinery. So they generally have some loans that they need to take, for which their debt goes higher, and that increases the debt to equity ratio. But compared to the industry standard, the Moltech manages to hold it off very well. It has a good debt to equity ratio compared to the industry. EBITDA is also stands very good for the company at 96.56 last year. And as you can see, it has always been increasing through the last 5 years. So that is also not a cause of worry for any of the investors. Other data, the PE by E stands at a lower size. That means that it's not overvalued. It stands at an average above average side of 23.1. The ROE, the return on equity, stands at 21.2%, which is very, very good. And even the ROCE at 22% is a great number. These are all great figures that are green signs for the investors to pitch in their money and to invest in such a stock. So even if you look at now, what are the future prospects of the same? So as you can see very clearly that there has been high growth over the past 2 years, and even despite the dip, there has been growth in there is a growth expected in the next quarter as well. So when you look very carefully, you can see that 2022 and 2023, the increase is even higher than what it is for the last couple of years. It is expected to grow even faster, which is in itself a very big point, because you would expect that, you know, it has shown such great results. Now there could be a decline, but even now, despite everything that has happened, it is expected that it will grow at similar rates. So now moving on to the SWOT analysis. Right. So this is they have shown a consistent high return stocks over the 5 years. They have had a consistently, they have given good dividends. They have paid off their stocks very well. They have high TTM EPS growth. They have very low debt compared to the industry. Though if you compare it to the service industry, obviously it would be pretty high. And it could be lower in the future. But since this company has not yet, it's not expanded into other territories, and if it does, then maybe perhaps it would be able to generate even more revenues. It has an increasing revenue every quarter for the past 2 quarters. Even though the revenue decreased the last year, for the past 2 quarters, especially, the revenue has been increasing. The FII, FPI, or the institutions, the foreign institutions, have increased their shareholding. This is a positive sign. Recent results, growth in operating profit with increasing operating margins. So there has been, even when the operating profit has been increasing, they have had their margins increase as well. So they have been able to, as I showed you, the profits never decreased even through COVID. They managed to sustain their increase in profit throughout COVID, which is a very great point. Coming to the weaknesses, however, it is a... I'll come to the threats first. So opportunities first. It has a very high momentum score of technical scores of greater than 50. So that is another great sign that, you know, since it's a company that has such high technical scores, that means that other investors have looked into it. Other investors have decided that this is a great stock. And overall, the technical analysis, the current analysis of the company reveals that it gives a positive score. It is able to sustain itself throughout. I'll discuss some of the weaknesses, even though they're not on the screen because of some technical error. So I'll just discuss the weaknesses myself. There has been a decline in the net profit with falling profit margin. So there has also been on the quarter-on-quarter basis. So the profit that we discussed was on year-on-year basis, but in the quarter-on-quarter basis, there has been a decline in the net profit. There has been a promoter decreasing in their shareholding. So even though the FII, FPIs have been investing more, the promoters, their own company promoters, have decided to decrease their shareholding, which could be a red signal. Annual net profit has been declining, and high promoters for stock pledges. So I'll come to the figure. I think there has been a very high, they have a very high promoter stock percentage for their shares, which is a little scary for such a company, but we'll come to that why there is. And they have the highest increases in pledges by promoters. So this promoters having pledged their shares, this sticks out as a sore point for the company. But otherwise, I think it manages to keep itself as a good stock. Going on to the threats, it's a stock with expensive valuations according to the trendline valuation score. It's a company where promoters have increased their pledge stocks, as I just discussed. The insiders have sold their stocks. The promoters have sold their stocks, which is a warning signal of sorts. This is the shareholding pattern. As I was discussing right now, you can see that the majority of the shares are being owned by the promoters and then and the general public, which is a good sign. If the general public owns a lot of the shares, that means there's a lot of liquidity and there is availability of the shares as well, which is a positive sign going forward. And the rest of the figures, 14.7% for banks and mutual funds, 8.29% for foreign institutions, even though the foreign institutions have been increasing it nowadays, as I just discussed. The other data for the company varies from market cap at 1,352 crore, which is good, but it can obviously increase if they increase their revenue, their non-core income activities as well. The pledged shares, as I have been discussing time and again, has been 2.89%, which is a negative point for them, since the pledged shares could be lower and they have had the highest increase in them over the past years, which have been bad. There has been no resigned auditor during the company, so that's a good sign. The Pitarski score has been 7, which is above average. The Altman Z score has been 6.95, which is a good sign. And the Modified C score has been 1. So what this means is that the company Modified C score means is that it does not appear that they have tampered with their financials. The Altman Z score shows that they do not face any issue of facing bankruptcy anytime soon. And Pitarski F score is generally a good indicator for seeing how they have performed financially. Coming to the turnover ratios, they have showed great turnover over the past 5 years. They have had a slight dip this year, as I said again, due to COVID. They were able to sustain only a 6.676% growth. But over the few years, they have had a good percentage score at 8.89, good ratio, sorry, at 8.89, 8.87, 8.75, 8.30. While their asset turnover ratio has also been very high at 109.676% this year, 120.63% last year, and so on. They had only one stock split in the entire period, which was in 2016, where their face value changed from 10 to 5. The stock price CAGR is very high, especially for the last year, because their growth has been so high. This is a very, very particular stock that has had a very amazing growth story over the last 1 year, especially. Even though their revenues fell during 2020, they showed such a great score, and you can see that reflected here with a 66% stock price CAGR, 14% in the 3 years, 18% in the 5 years, and a consistent growth of 32% in the 10 years. So before I conclude this, however, I have a lot of points that I want to discuss otherwise for this company as well. Since this is a very particular stock, I had a few points that I just wanted to explain from my side as well as So why this stock stands apart, why is it that it is so, you know, different from the others, is that this company produces small plastic parts, small things. It produces plastic paints for the paint industry, but they completely rule over that market. They completely have a monopoly over it, and they deal with all the major market leaders. They provide innovation in packaging solutions, which is a big point for them. So the other point that they have to their advantage is that they implement backward integration. So they are possibly the only Indian packaging company to develop in-house molds, robots, and labels, whereas competitors mainly rely on imports. So they themselves develop it, which is another positive point. They have a deep-rooted customer relationship, but they also face some slight risks with the ban on plastic packaging. So if they do face that in the future, it could be a problem for them. It could be a problematic area for them. But otherwise, I feel that this stock is definitely worth your time and you should definitely look into it. And obviously, you should conduct your own research before you go ahead and purchase anything. Thank you so much.
Wonderful, wonderful, Rahul. Great presentation and probably giving your insights about this Multec packaging and also what are the threats. So one point that I would like all my viewers to listen is that Warren Buffett and many more people have said that probably if you're investing into a stock, do not go blindly into technicals or the numbers which are shown by the numbers by the company. You should actually learn what exactly is the business of the company. If that business is something which probably next 10, 15 years or 20 years down the line that probably you and me would be buying, it is a part of some essential group, then I guess we need to understand business of the company first, then before diving deep into the numbers, what is their ROCE, what is their ROE, what is the asset turnover ratios, that thing is completely different. First need try and understand the business of the company. Say for example, Multec packaging is actually manufacturing packaging products for companies like which are into essential like lubricating oils. Like they have 90% share of Shell and Castrol. They are a big part of paint industry like Asian, Berger. These are part of essential. You and me would be driving our two-wheelers, four-wheelers. You and me would be painting our houses. Like, so having a good market share in an essential industry and probably holding a share of more than 60-70%, I think that is what separates Multec packaging from other companies. And all the more reason that in last 10 years, it has given you 32% of returns, right? 32% CAGR returns. Which is almost like it would be like 15, 20 times in last 10 odd years. So very good presentation, Rahul. Excellent presentation. And to all the viewers who are watching it still live, thank you so much. We are moving on to our last talk, which is Fortis Healthcare. And probably by diving deep into this sector or probably this talk, you will be more or less acknowledging why companies like Suprajit, Davies or Multec are doing good. And why companies like Fortis, which relatively low numbers of ROE, ROCE, are not doing very well on the business side and as well as stock market side as well. So over to Meenakshi to present the last talk of the day, Fortis.
Thank you, sir. So welcome again, everyone, for the final talk of the day, Fortis Healthcare. So today, every metropolitan city we see has urban area, suburban area, we see has one of the very good, luxurious, we can say, healthcare facility available. And Fortis is one of the very big and good name in that sector, we can say. But as sir mentioned, why we are seeing currently Fortis as an average, or we can say not less compared to the other stocks we saw today. So let's dive into it. So the first, let's talk about the activities of the company. What exactly Fortis does and which sector it belongs to. So it belongs to, as mentioned, healthcare industry. As the pandemic hit us, we have seen that along with as many of the economies fell, but the pharma healthcare sector, we can see, and the FMCG sector, these are the sectors which have seen a good boom in their growth. These are only a few to name. Talking about the healthcare sector, Indian healthcare and hospitality sector, it is expected to grow at a CAGR of 18%. We can also we can also see a growth of 16% CAGR in for the next 2 years. That is a very good segment. Point to be noted for healthcare industry. And now talking about Fortis, we can say has currently 27 hospitals across India. And we can see that Fortis has majorly more areas in the metropolitan cities as mentioned earlier. So it includes mainly Delhi, Maharashtra, such big Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, these nations. So Fortis Limited is actually IHH Healthcare Bharat Company initiative. So Fortis is generally a tie-up with a global brand which has its branches in India and as well as UAE and Sri Lanka. So this justifies the luxurious amenities Fortis provides, which matches the international standards as well, which makes it quite costly for currently the population for the normal low income group and middle income group people of India, but it tries to provide world class patient care and superlative facilities. Now talking about the board of directors of Fortis Healthcare, we have Ravi Rajgopal as the independent director and chairman. We have Shirish Moheshwar Ape, the vice chairman of Fortis, and other prominent members as Dr. Ashutosh, Shailaja Chandra and other reputed names handling the management of the company. Now, talking about the shareholding pattern of the company, we have 30% FIIs holding in the company. Moreover, we can see that DIIs have a stronghold of 15% in the company and 23% is contributed by others. We can see that the company, there has been no promotion of pledging of shares by promoters, and FIS2 also, as it's a collaboration with a foreign brand, we can that justifies a little bit of foreign investment in the company. Moving on, we have, let's have a quick short SWOT analysis of the company. We can see that there is a rising net cash flow and cash flow from operating activities. The technical chart shows a bullish harami for as of now for the company. But let's not directly jump on a conclusion based on that. We have other factors, fundamental factors and ratios and financials to consider as well. The company has shown good quarterly growth in the recent results. There has been growth in net profit with increasing profit margin quarter on quarter. The company has not though zero, but a low debt as of now. The increasing revenue every quarter for the past 4 quarters. There has been increasing in profit every quarter for the past 4 years. The company shows strong cash generating ability from core business, improving cash flow from operations for the past 2 years. As mentioned earlier, the company is with zero promoter pledge. The recent results show growth in operating profit with increase in operating margins as well. And the current share price of the company is near its 52-week high. Now, talking about other factors of the company, its weakness, we can say, is high interest payments compared to earnings. So the company has high interest to pay compared to and is earning less. That is a factor to see here. The company has high PE with negative return on equity. So that is a red flag for the investors. Along with that, the company also has a low Petrosky score, which implies that the company has a weak financials. Opportunities, we can see that the company recovered good from its 52-week low, and the threats, as mentioned earlier, the firms linked to ongoing regulatory investigations, legal cases. So the company is currently linked with legal cases. If it goes south, then that might cause a problem to the company. There has also been an increasing trend in non-core income, and it is a stock with high PE. So these are some of the threats of the company. Now having a look on the financials, we can see that the operating income from cash flow from operating activities has decreased. We can also see that the cash flow from investing has also decreased. It's negative. The net change is though positive. That is also a point to note here. Some of the key highlights we can say for the company is as the pandemic hit, there has been rapid. They have been providing rapid tests for COVID-19. They have conducted as of now 2.5 million COVID-19 tests. Net debt to EBITDA is 1.04. They have PBT at 42 crores and EBITDA at 451 crores. The total revenue of the company is 4,000 crores. We can see these good figures, we can see that the company has a high PE. So let's dive into that. Before that, we can see some more financial parameters. We have the company. The total liabilities of the company has maintained increased from the past year. The total assets have also increased. The net working capital has increased from a negative 1,129 to a positive 216. We can see that the PBT has decreased from the past 2 years. We can also see that the PAT has decreased. So that is also, these are also red flags, we can say, for the investors. Now, having a look on the ratios, we have liquidity ratio. The first is current ratio. The current ratio has shown a downward trend. Even though having a very low in 2020, it has managed to gain a good high at 0.84, but still it is low. So that is also a red flag for the investors. The quick ratio also, though falling to 0.33 in 2020, it has managed to rise, but it is still low, less than 1. So that is also a factor, negative factor to consider as of now. Now talking about solvency ratio, the debt to equity ratio has decreased in the past 5 years. So this is a good positive factor for the company. Moreover, but again, we have the profitability ratio, the net profit margin, which is negative for the past 5 years. So this shows that it is one of the very big red flag for investors right now, that it is though decreasing. Other important ratios include inventory turnover ratio, which has been decreasing from the past 5 years. The EV by EBITDA has managed to stay at within a proper range, though not very increased much, but it's still in an average range, we can say. The price by book value has also increased in the past 5 years, but we can see that it is 2.45. So we can say that the company is overvalued maybe, but as compared to Divis, and when I mentioned earlier that in case of Divis, it was worth it. But now we can say that though the prior company is overvalued, so as of now, the investors can wait before moving ahead with this stock and keep an eye on all the ratios and the movement of for the next quarter results. The asset turnover ratio has also decreased in the past 5 years, has been fluctuating. There has been not a standard range, we can say. And return on capital employed has also been decreasing in the past 5 years, which is also a red flag for the company. Now, comparing Fortis with its peers, though the PE ratio of Fortis is comparatively very high as compared to its peers, the book price to book value, though very low as compared to other competitors, still it is a matter of concern. Moreover, the EV to EBITDA ratio is also very much low as compared to other peers. So we can say that Fortis is not good at performing as compared to its peers like Apollo, Max, Metropolis, and Narayana. So that is also a factor to consider. Now looking at the technicals, as I mentioned, it has recently touched its 52-week high and has closed today at previous close was at 290. Though showing a upward rising trend, and as I mentioned, it is an overvalued stock, we can say that investors should wait and observe this stock and add it to their watch list before making a decision and going ahead with this, as there are many red flags compared to the green flags we have seen. So the investors should right now wait. That again, all of them should do your own research before investing in any stock. So that's all from my side. Thank you.
Meenakshi, and presenting two stocks in a day, it does take a lot of time to research for almost 3 to 4 hours every day and to present such beautiful numbers with graphs and all the minute details of the stock that we need to research. So it was a very good presentation on your part, even after devoting so many hours with your college also. So viewers, to all of you, a big thanks. And probably if you might be noticing certain glitches, certain apprehension from the speaker about presenting the stock, but then they all are 2021 year old students who are presenting it first time live. So you can like the video and you can share it with your friends if you have really liked the research part. I think we have covered 3 great stocks today. And to all of you, thank you so much. With this, we're ending our presentation.